Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to worship on this, the 21st Sunday after Pentecost. On behalf of American Lutheran Church, I welcome all to worship this morning. We extend a special welcome to all that are visiting with us this morning. During our worship service this morning, we'll be sharing in the sacrament of Holy Communion, and all are welcome to come to the table. No matter where you are in your faith journey, come and share in God's goodness given in bread and wine, the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Today at American Lutheran, we'll be celebrating communion by intinction. That's the dipping of the bread into the wine. We'll have four stations, and we will also be serving our young people who aren't taking communion yet fish crackers. Again, all are welcome to the table. After worship today, all are invited to the fellowship hall for a time of coffee and conversation. There is no Sunday school today for our youth, but there will be an adult education class during that fellowship hour. We ask that you please keep in your prayers all those that are in need of God's healing. And we especially lift up Deb Pauley, Cheryl Pauley, Laverne Hedman, Wade Frosch, Cody Seehofer, Janelle Kelly, Gordon Jarman, Alicia Bestie, Dennis Brock, Margaret Melhoff, and all others that are in need of healing. We also ask that you continually lift up Jordan Hinge in your prayers. Again, Jordan is over in Turkey serving as a missionary for this year. I want to thank all those who are helping us out in worship. Gary, we thank you for setting everything up for us this morning from the AV booth. We thank our greeters and ushers and communion servers. We thank Amber Unzen, our acolyte. And we thank Gail, we thank you for your gift of music. We also want to thank all those who helped decorate the church. You know, I went home on, on Tuesday, came back on Wednesday, and this place was totally changed. It was just beautiful. And we thank all those people that put in their time and efforts to make this church ready for the season. And we also thank the quilters for all that they've done. I think, Betty, you're going to tell us a little bit about that in just a minute, but today this is Quilt Sunday, and it is amazing how many quilts we have here. After the worship service, we're going to ask you to help us pack all these up, fold them up, and get them ready to be taken down to Watertown. But, Betty, why don't you come and tell us a little bit about that now?
Thank you. We are sending these to on Monday, which is tomorrow, and so we have to pack them up today. And if you could bring them to the front, our boxes are in the back, so that would help us, and we'll fold them and package them up. We have to label them and that sort of thing. And there's also a notice that we need a little money for shipping. People that have been shipping ours were very reasonable, but now we are just using a regular trucking line, so we need a little more money. So if you could please help. And I also want to thank everyone for donating their sheets and fabric and thread and money. We really appreciate it, and we'll continue making. And also, if anyone wants to help us, every second and fourth Tuesday, thank you.
Betty, how many are there here?
There's 82.
82. Okay, fantastic. There's a fifth quarter this Friday evening after the football game with Sisseton. All are invited to come and celebrate with us after the game because I know it's going to be a victory. It's assured. But we do need people to help us serve as well. So if you can help us serve, please sign up in the narthex. There's also a number of other things in the narthex to sign up for at the Welcome Center. Please take a look at all those many things. If you're interested in becoming a member at American Lutheran Church, I'd ask that you please visit with me after the worship service today or sometime in the next couple of weeks. Are there any other announcements today? If not, please stand for the confession and forgiveness. Thank you. Blessed be the Holy Trinity. One God, the only Sovereign who dwells in light, Christ Jesus who came to save sinners, the Holy Spirit who lives within us. Amen. Let us confess our sins in the presence of God and one another. God of overflowing grace, we come to you with repentant hearts. Forgive us for shallow thankfulness. Forgive us for passing by the ones in need. Forgive us for setting our hopes on fleeting treasures. Forgive us our neglect and thoughtlessness. Bring us home from the wilderness of sin and strengthen us to serve you in all that we do and say. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. There is joy in heaven over every sinner who repents. By the grace of God in Christ Jesus, who gave himself up for us all, your sins are forgiven and you are made free. Rejoice with the angels and with one another. We are at home in God's mercy now and forever. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Since the feast of victory.
Almighty and most merciful God, your bountiful goodness fills all creation. Keep us safe from all that may hurt us, that whole and well in body and spirit, we may with grateful hearts accomplish all that you would have us do. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
Okay, the first reading today is read from 2 Kings chapter 5, verses 1 through 3 and 7 through 15. Naaman, commander of the army of the king of Aram, was a great man and in high favor with his master, because by him the Lord had given victory to Aram. The man, though a mighty fighter, suffered from leprosy. Now the Aramaeans, on one of their raids, had taken a young girl captive from the land of Israel, and she served Naaman's wife. She said to her mistress, "If only my Lord were with the prophet who is in Samaria, he would cure him of his leprosy." When the king of Israel read the letter, he tore his clothes and said, "Am I God to give death or life that this man sends word to me to cure a man of his leprosy? Just look and see how he is trying to pick a quarrel with me." But when Elisha, the man of God, heard that the king of Israel had torn his clothes, he sent a message to the king, "Why have you torn your clothes? Let him come to me, that he may learn that there is a prophet in Israel." So Naaman came with his horses and chariots and halted at the entrance of Elisha's house. Elisha sent a messenger to him, saying, "Go wash in the Jordan 7 times, and your flesh shall be restored, and you shall be clean." But Naaman became angry and went away, saying, "I thought that for me he would surely come out and stand and call on the name of the Lord his God, and would wave his hand over the spot and cure the leprosy. Are not Abana and Pharpar, the rivers of Damascus, better than all the waters of Israel? Could I not wash in them and be clean?" He turned and went away in rage. But his servants approached him and said to him, "Father, if the prophet had commanded you to do something difficult, would you have not done it? How much more when all he has said to you was, 'Wash and be clean'?" So he went down and immersed himself 7 times in the Jordan, according to the word of the man of God. His flesh was restored like the flesh of a young boy, and he was clean. Then he returned to the man of God, he and all his company. He came and stood before him and said, "Now I know that there is no God in all the earth except in Israel." The word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 111 will be read responsively by full verse. Alleluia, I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart, in the assembly of the upright, in the congregation. Great are your works, O Lord, pondered by all who delight in them. Majesty and splendor mark your deeds, and your righteousness endures forever. Your God's compassion, your gracious and full of compassion. You give food to those who fear you, remembering forever your covenant.
You have shown your people the power of your works, giving them the lands of the nations.
The works of your hands are faithfulness and just. All of your precepts are sure. You sent redemption to your people and commanded your covenant forever. Holy and awesome is your name.
All who practice this have a good understanding. God's praise endures forever.
A reading from Paul's second letter to Timothy, the second chapter. Remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, a descendant of David. That is my gospel, for which I suffer hardship, even to the point of being chained like a criminal. But the word of God is not chained. Therefore, I endure everything for the sake of the elect, so that they may also obtain the salvation that is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. The saying is sure: if we have died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, he will also deny us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. Remind them of this and warn them before God that they are to avoid the wrangling over your words, which does no good but only ruins those who are listening. Do your best to present yourself to God as one approved by him, a worker who has no need to be ashamed, rightly explaining the word of truth. Word of God, word of life.
The Gospel according to Luke, the 17th chapter. On the way to Jerusalem, Jesus was going through the region between Samaria and Galilee. As he entered a village, 10 lepers approached him. Keeping their distance, they called out, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When Jesus saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourself to the priests." And as they went, they were made clean. Then one of them, when he saw he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. He prostrated himself at Jesus' feet and thanked him. And he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus asked, "Were not 10 made clean? But the other 9, where are they? Was none of them found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" Then he said to him, "Get up and go on your way. Your faith has made you well." The word of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and Jesus Christ our Lord and Savior. Amen. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. 2 weeks ago, I attended a South Dakota Synod theological retreat, and the main theme of the retreat was Martin Luther and the Reformation. You see, in just a few weeks, we at American Lutheran, along with Lutherans all over the world, will start a celebration of a year-long celebration of the 500th anniversary of Martin Luther nailing the 95 Theses to the church door in Wittenberg, Germany, which was the event that really kick-started the Reformation. And the Reformation, well, that was a world-changing event. At the retreat, we spent a majority of our time listening to these two speakers, one tell about Luther and the other one telling about a trip that he had made following the path of Luther. And during their stories, they included a story about today's text and Martin Luther. It was amid all of the various ecclesial, ethical, and liturgical reforms that were taking place during this Martin Luther era that Luther was asked the question, "What is real worship?" And his answer, the 10th leper turning back. Now, to understand what Luther was trying to say about worship, we need to turn our attentions to a few of the details in today's gospel story. In today's gospel, Luke begins by reminding us that Jesus and his entourage are on their way to Jerusalem, and that Jesus decided to take a path less traveled in a region between Samaria and Galilee. The problem is that Samaria and Galilee are butted up against each other. There's really no region between. And even if there was, this isn't the route that Jesus would probably have taken. So you kind of wonder if Luke was a little geographically challenged when it came to Israel, or maybe it wasn't Luke's intent that we really concentrate on where Jesus was at or where he was going. Maybe he's trying to say something to us theologically instead of geographically. You see, Jesus is on his way to Jerusalem, where he will be given a royal welcome of palm branches and hosannas. But then later on in the week, he'll be nailed to the cross. And Jesus knows all of this. He knows that this is his last journey. And so during these travels to Jerusalem, travels that are highlighted in Luke's gospel from chapters 9 through 19, a section of Luke's gospel known as the travel narratives, it's in this portion of Luke's gospel that Jesus reveals to his followers the true nature of the coming kingdom. And he's telling his disciples how to be disciples. Many of the encounters that take place in this portion of Luke's gospel happen not in exact locales then, but in places where teaching can take place. They happen often in Luke's gospel at a certain place, or as in today's text, in a region between. It happens in places where one might expect there was some kind of tension between the ethnic and the religious differences, and where differences are real and evident. For what God inaugurates through Jesus is made manifest in a certain place or in a region between. Second, we find that much of what happens in today's story is fairly typical of other things that happen in Luke's gospel. Neither his pattern of healing, which begins with a plea for mercy from the lepers, and then to the command that Jesus gives to go to the priest, nor the response of worship from the tenth leper who returns to prostrate, praise, and give thanks, is all that unique to this story. You'll find it in numerous stories in Luke's gospel. All of these things happen at various times in the gospel. And so they become ordinary in Luke's gospel. But it's against this ordinary Lukean backdrop that there are three details found in today's gospel that make this particular story special. First in the story, Jesus gives a command to the 10 lepers to follow the law. Luke wrote, "As Jesus entered a village, 10 lepers approached him. Keeping their distance, the lepers called out saying, 'Jesus, Master, have mercy on us.' When Jesus saw them, he said to them, 'Go and show yourself to the priest.' And as they went, they were made clean." Jesus gives the lepers a command to do what the law says that they're supposed to do. They have to go to the priest to become clean, to be allowed back into society. But then one of the 10 comes back to him and prostrates himself at his feet and gives thanks. And Jesus then asks what I think is a very head-scratching question. He asks the 10th leper, "Where are the other 9? To which the expected answer should have been, "They're going to show themselves to the priest just like they're supposed to do according to the law and just like you told them to do." So why does Jesus ask this question? We'll come back to that in just a minute. The second head scratcher in this fact is the fact that the 10th leper that comes back and worships is a Samaritan. Or as Jesus describes him, he's a foreigner. He's a person that first century Jews would not consider to be an example of faithfulness, and would not be somebody that they would think that Jesus would even spend any time with. But in his gospel, Luke will at times insert those who are considered to be outsiders so that change can be featured. Remember the story of the Good Samaritan. Well, he stuck that Good Samaritan in there so that we would think about what that Good Samaritan did. And so in the midst of the ordinary, there is this realization that something extraordinary is going to happen. So when Jesus says to this foreigner, this Samaritan, "Your faith has made you well," people like us, we need to pay attention to what's just happened. We need to pay attention to what's being said. Third, it's interesting that in today's gospel, in verse 19, it reads, "Your faith will make you well." Your faith has been made well. But in the Message Bible, that same verse reads, "Your faith has healed and saved you." And in the King James Version, it reads, "Your faith has made you whole." The word that is used, that we read as to be made well, is the verb sozo in Greek. And sozo can be translated as healed, made well, but it also means saved and made whole. And each of those words can change the meaning and understanding of what's taking place today in this gospel reading. So maybe Luke is trying to say to this 10th leper that this healing miracle is more than just making yourself okay. Maybe there's more to it than that. Maybe there's a spiritual aspect to it, a theological aspect. Maybe Jesus, by the way of talking to this leper who has returned, is illustrating for his first century followers and us that faith is not just a matter of believing. There's more to it than that. There's seeing. There's understanding. There's behaving differently because of that. In today's gospel, all 10 of the lepers are healed. But there's one who Luke tells us sees that he's healed. And it's in his seeing that he recognizes who Jesus is. And he perceives that Jesus is the one that brings healing and wholeness. And when he lets that understanding sink in, it makes a difference in his life. Because the 10th leper was able to see what has happened, he changes direction in his life. Instead of following the law, instead of running off to the priest, he turns and returns to Jesus. And he sees a new understanding for his life. Because the 10th leper sees what has happened, it's in a seeing that he, this leper, this Samaritan, this foreigner, recognizes who Jesus is. Somebody from the outside seeing who Jesus is. He recognizes that Jesus is the one that is bringing a new kingdom, a new understanding of life for all, a new way of seeing. And because the 10th leper sees what has happened, he goes to Jesus, prostrates himself at Jesus' feet, and gives himself up to praise and thanksgiving. Because this leper sees, he understands the need to worship. I see today's gospel as an invitation for all of us to recognize, to realize that when we see the gospel, when we look through the eyes of the gospel, it makes a difference in who we are, how we behave, what we believe. Because of the gospel of Jesus Christ, in the face of adversity, do we see danger or can we see opportunity? When we see things that are happening in Haiti, where the country is devastated again, do we see a demand for our things that we have, or can we see them as a gift given to a people in need? In the face of a stranger, do we see a potential enemy, or is it possible to see a new friend? When we look through eyes of the gospel, do we see a God who is a stern judge, or can we see a loving parent? When we look at ourselves in the mirror, seeing through eyes of the gospel, do we see a failure or can we see a beloved child of God? And when we look at our future, looking at it through the eyes of the gospel, will we see an uncertain future or a potential for new horizons? Now, there's no right answer to any of the questions that were just on the screen. Other than how we answer depends on how we see. Yet how we see the gospel will dramatically shape our beliefs, our outlooks, and eventually our behavior. It's how we see and ultimately believe that allows us to find within us the ability to understand what the 10th leper actually did when he turned and returned to Jesus Christ. Because you see, through the gospel, we see the world in a different way. And when we start seeing in those different ways, then we understand why we need to worship. Why do we need to fall at Jesus' feet and give thanks and praise? Thanks be to God. Amen. Could I have all those quilters that have helped with all these 82 quilts? Could you please stand up at this time? And I think we need to recognize what they've done over a year's time. We thank you so very much. We worship today in a sanctuary adorned with quilts pieced together by members of our quilting ministry from remnants and bits of discarded fabric. It is our purpose to dedicate these quilts to the use of a holy God who is always taking common and discarded things and using them for holy purposes. In every generation, the primary symbol that we as Christians follow is the cross. But in our generation, the secondary symbol of Christianity might be the patchwork quilts. With joy and humility, therefore, we offer these quilts to our Creator and Redeemer as an extension of ourselves and of the discipleship with which God has entrusted us. So let us pray. Most merciful Father, receive these quilts, the work of our hands, and go with them into the streets and homes where we cannot go. Shelter from sin and sickness those who wrap themselves in these, our gifts. Grant that your children who find warmth in these quilts may also know the comfort of your fatherly arms, and renew us in Christ-like compassion through him in whom all who are weary and heavy laden can find rest. Amen. Please stand. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord.
He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Set free by the truth of God's gracious love, we pray for the church, the world, and all of God's good creation. O God, we pray for the church here on earth. Make us one in spirit wherever we meet and however we worship. Hear us, O God. We pray for the health of the life-giving waters of creation. Guard them from misuse and pollution. Hear us, O God. We pray for leaders in Milbank, in South Dakota, in our nation, and across the globe. Equip them to work for justice for all people. Hear us, O God. We pray for those who are sick or in pain, for those who feel unclean in body or spirit, and for those in need of healing. Hear us, O God. We pray for American Lutheran Church. Send your Spirit to inspire us in word and deed of healings in our neighborhood and wider community. Hear us, O God. We give thanks for the faithfully departed, and we wait for the day when we join with them in thanks and praise around your heavenly throne. Hear us, O God. At your hands, faithful God, we place ourselves in our prayers, spoken and unspoken, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us share the peace with one another. God's peace. God's peace. God, as grains of wheat scattered upon the hill were gathered together to become one bread, so let your church be gathered together from the ends of the earth into your kingdom. For yours is the glory through Jesus Christ, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Holy God, our bread of life, our table and our food, you created a world in which all might be satisfied by your abundance. You dined with Abraham and Sarah, promising them life, and fed your people Israel with manna from heaven. You sent your Son to eat with sinners and to become food for the world. In the night he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took the bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again after supper he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant of my blood, shed for you and for all people. Do this in remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Take hold of the life that is really is life. Come, take your place at the table. Please be seated. We come again to you, O God, giving you thanks that in this feast of mercy you have embraced us and healed us, making us one in the body of Christ. Go with us on our way. Equip us for every good work, that we may continue to give you thanks by embracing others with mercy and healing. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please stand. And now unto him who is able to keep us from falling and lift us up from the dark valleys of despair to the mountains of hope, from the midnight of desperation to the daybreak of joy, to him be power and authority forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. We ask this in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Serve the Lord.